Hi everyone and welcome back to this channel. Here's another video with signals and systems exercises, and the Fourier transform is a very important topic, so I want to make sure you get familiar with it. I'm Gio, an assistant professor at UPF in Barcelona, and I'm an expert in wireless communications. On my channel I also upload theory and tutorial classes on signals and systems, so this is the right channel for you if you want to learn the fundamentals of signals and systems rather quickly through theory and examples. Let's get started. So the first exercise for today is labeled as exercise number 6. We should consider an ideal delay system where the output y of t is given by x of t minus 1/2, where x of t is the input of the system. So we should derive the system's frequency response from the Fourier transform and its property. So let's do that first. So the frequency response is the Fourier transform of the impulse response h of t. So first of all, let's take the Fourier transform of both sides, y of t and therefore x of t minus 1/2. So we get this equality, and of course by definition the Fourier transform of y of t is capital Y of j omega, and the Fourier transform of x of t minus 1/2 is the Fourier transform of x of t times e to minus j omega half. This is because of the time shifting property in the time domain that corresponds to a multiplication by a complex exponential in the frequency domain. So the frequency response h of j omega is defined as the ratio between the Fourier transform of the output and the Fourier transform of the input, so it's readily obtained as e to minus j omega half. In part B of the exercise, we should plot magnitude and phase of this frequency response. The magnitude is simply 1, so it's really easy to plot it. And the phase is also quite easy because it's just minus half omega, so it's a linear phase, linearly decreasing. So if I want to plot it, it just looks like this at the bottom right. So the next exercise is about an LTI system where we're given the equation between the output y of t and the input, and it's the one that you see at the top of this slide. So we should determine the impulse response of the system. This is actually rather easy. The impulse response is given by delta of t plus 1 plus 2 delta of t plus delta of t minus 2. Why is that? Well, let's recall that when we do the convolution between a certain signal and a delta of t minus t0, the result is just a shift by the quantity t0, so it's x of t minus t0, right? So this is what we get when we do the convolution between delta of t plus 1 and the input to delta of t and the input and delta of t minus 2 and the input. So we get the three terms, so the output y of t readily follows from that. Now part B of the exercise is about the frequency response of the system by calculating the Fourier transform of the impulse response. Okay, so now we have h of t, we calculate the Fourier transform. This is really easy again, because of the superposition property, we can just calculate the three different Fourier transforms for the three impulses that constitute the impulse response and then sum the result. And this is what we get. We get e to j omega plus 2 plus e to minus j to omega. Finally, we should determine the output when the system has as an input x of t equal to e to j omega t, which is a simple complex exponential, okay? And we should demonstrate that this is actually equivalent to multiplying the input by h of j omega. And this is actually the case, as I will show you, because the complex exponentials are what we call eigenfunctions of LTI systems. So the output y of t, as you see at the bottom of the slide, is given by the convolution, as usual, between the input and the impulse response, okay? So if we calculate this explicitly and we remember the property at the top right, written in red, well, then we have e to j omega t plus 1 plus 2 e to j omega plus e to j omega t minus 2. And then I can write this by grouping all the terms and multiply the complex exponential. Then I notice that the term in square brackets is precisely h of j omega, and therefore I can write The output as E to j omega t, h of j omega as the exercise part C suggests correctly. And again, this is because the complex exponentials are eigenfunctions of LTI systems. So our next exercise is number 8. So here we should use the convolution property to determine some inverse Fourier transform. So we have y of j omega defined as the product of two functions. So we know that product in the frequency domain corresponds to convolution in the time domain. So I can calculate y of t as the convolution of the two anti-Fourier transforms of those two terms, okay? And what would those be? Okay, so I recall that it is a rectangular pulse signal that has a sync shape Fourier transform, okay? So if a signal z of t, and we've seen this in previous exercises, is 1 between minus t1 and t1 with a generic t1, it's like a parameter, okay? Then this is what the Fourier transform z of j omega looks like. It's 2t1 sine of omega t1 over omega t1. I've written it in the standard sync form here, okay? But of course, then t1 and t1 can be simplified, as we'll see. Right, so now let's define for convenience a signal x1 of t, which is 1 between minus 1 and 1, and x2 of t, which is 1 between minus 2 and 2, okay? But it's useful to define these signals. Also, if I simplify in z of j omega t1 with t1, and I write 2 at the denominator, okay, this is what I get. I get that sine of omega t1 over half omega is actually the Fourier transform of z of t, which is defined as 1 between minus t1 and t1. Therefore, I know that the term sine of 2 omega over half omega has as anti-transform x2, and the term sine of omega over half omega has for anti-transform x1 of t, right? So I already find that the y of t I'm looking for is given by the convolution between x2 of t and x1 of t, which I have defined simply as rectangular pulses that just have different duration, okay? Cool. So let's just write it down. Let's write down in red the expression for x1 of t and x2 of t, and now we can work out the convolution between them. So let's do that by making some space. So again, I just use the definition of the convolution integral, okay, and I simplify it because x1 only runs between minus 1 and 1, so I get this integral. And it's easy to solve this integral graphically by drawing signals, as I will show you. So this is x2 of tau, okay? In my integral, I have x2 of t minus tau. So first of all, let's observe that this is an even signal, so it's symmetric. So x2 of tau is the same as x2 of minus tau. So I can rewrite the integral as the integral of x2 of tau minus t. This integral is in d tau, so the variable is tau, okay? And t is just a shift, is a parameter that shifts my signal across values of tau. So what do I mean by that? Okay, let's see. So we need to calculate this integral. So when t is larger than 3, that means that I'm shifting my signal x2 of tau minus t by a quantity t that is larger than 3. So that means that my signal ends up there where you see the dotted red drawing. It falls outside of the integration boundaries, which are between minus 1 and 1, and I have marked in light blue for convenience in the figure. Okay, so in that case, obviously the integral is 0 if there is a shift t larger than 3. So similarly, when there's a shift t smaller than minus 3, meaning there's this anticipation by a quantity at least minus 3, then you see that, again, the signal anticipated falls outside of the integration interval, so the integral result is 0. What about other cases? These are a little bit more tricky. They just require some more calculation. So when t is between minus 1 and 1, that means that I delay or anticipate my signal by a quantity that is at most 1, okay? So for example, the red original x2 signal becomes this dotted green signal, okay? So it's shifted, but a little bit, not that much. So when this shifted is at most 1 or minus 1, then still the whole integration interval between minus 1 and 1, the blue one, is contained inside my signal, okay? So the integral in this case is 2, the result of the integral. Okay, what about other cases, intermediate cases? So when t is between 1 and 3, it means that I'm delaying my signal by more than 1, but by less than 3. So here's what I get, like the purple representation. Okay, so still part of the signal is within the integration boundary, but not all of it. How much is within the integration boundary? Well, I have to do 1 minus the left boundary, which is minus 2 plus t, where t is the shift. Okay, so if I just do this simple calculation, I see that the area, which I marked in purple, is 3 minus t. Okay, so I can write that 3 minus t is the result of the integral in this case. And then similarly, when t is between minus 3 and minus 1, so when there is an anticipation by at least 1, but by at most 3, again, there's a partial overlap between the integration boundaries and my signal, and the shaded area is, if I calculate it, 3 plus t, okay? So again, that's the result of the integral. So once I've done this, well, I have basically finished because I calculated my y of t. Maybe I can represent it just to have an idea of what it looks like, but I know pretty much what to expect when I do the convolution of two rectangular pulses. So let's represent it. So we see that it's 0 before minus 3 and after 3. And what about in between? Between minus 1 and 1, it's constant and it's 2. And before and after, it's given by some straight lines. Okay, t plus 3 and 3 minus t. So this is what it looks like. Cool. One more exercise. Now we need to determine the Fourier transform of these three signals. So let's start with the first one. It's a very simple one. We recall from previous exercises that the Fourier transform of two impulses symmetrically placed at plus and minus 1 is 2 cosine of omega. So this exercise is actually quite easy, and my x of j omega will be given by 2 plus 2 cosine of omega. So let's move on to part B, which is a little bit more involved. In this case, my signal x of t is 20 times the sine of 200 pi t minus 10 over pi t minus 10. So how to solve this? So first of all, I recall that this is a sine function, and the Fourier transform of a sine function is a rectangular pulse. Okay, so we need to find the right rectangular pulse. So let's define, for convenience, to get rid of those t minus 10 expressions, a signal z of t, which is a shifted version of x. So it's x of t plus 10, right? So it's anticipated. So this signal is simply 20 sine of 200 pi t over pi t. So it is a sine function, okay? I have gotten rid of the minus 10 for the moment. I'll bring it back later, okay? So now let's consider a rectangular pulse, okay, in the frequency domain. Y of j omega, which is 1, when the magnitude of omega is smaller than omega 0. That means between minus omega 0 and omega 0. Okay, so I find this signal and I do the anti-transform now. So the anti-transform of this, well, I expect a sine function, okay? So if I just solve the integral, which is easy, we've done this several times already, well, I can write this as a sine function, okay? The result is sine of omega 0 t over pi t. So what I have found is that a sine of omega 0 t over pi t has, for Fourier transform, the one on top. Okay, so 1 between minus omega 0 and omega 0. Then I can infer the Fourier transform of my z of t, which I wrote in green. Okay, because basically it's the same thing. It's just multiplied by 20, and the value of omega 0 is 200 pi. Okay, therefore, my z of j omega can be calculated easily, and it's 20 between minus 200 pi and 200 pi, okay, and zero elsewhere. Great, now I'm almost done because I know the Fourier transform of z of t. And what about the Fourier transform of x of t? Well, x of t is a shifted version, therefore its Fourier transform, being the Fourier transform of a shifted version of z, is z of j omega times e to minus j omega 10, where 10 is the amount of the time shift that I apply. Okay, so it will be given, as you see at the bottom right of the slide, it's 20 e to minus j omega 10 between minus 200 pi and 200 pi. And to conclude, the last part of the exercise gives x of t as e to minus 4t u of t minus e to minus 4t u of t minus 10. Okay, so how to calculate the Fourier transform of this? The first term is easy, it's a right-sided exponential. And if I just calculate it, I know that it's a first-order term. It's 1 over 4 plus j omega. What about the second term? Well, I find it convenient to rewrite it this way. So to write it as the Fourier transform of e to minus 4 t minus 10 u of t minus 10, and then compensate by post-multiplying by minus e to minus 4t, okay? So in this case, what I have is that the Fourier transform of e to minus 4 t minus 10 u of t minus 10, well, that's the shifted version of my original signal. So I know that that Fourier transform is the Fourier transform of the non-shifted signal times a complex exponential e to minus j 10 omega, okay? And then the final multiplying factor that I carry on with me. So I get the final result, which is, again, the first order term, but it's multiplied by two exponentials, okay? One real decaying exponential and another complex exponential. So the final result by summing those two terms up can be obtained, and it's given simply by 1 over 4 plus j omega times the term in the square brackets. So in this video, we have solved a few more useful exercises on the Fourier transform. I recommend watching the other exercise videos as well as my theory classes to better understand the fundamentals of the Fourier transform. And I'll keep uploading more exercise videos soon, so subscribe to this channel and you'll be the first one to know when I upload something new. See you in the next class.